don't need bigger knife.
He can't defend himself, though.
We are back. And you might thought I forgot about it, but I didn't. And Francis is carrying his 4V Native 5 lightweight, which that's a cool thing that exists.
Is it with the red FRN handles by any chance?
We're probably going to find out in chat here.
John
Mississauga is carrying his smock. Zinx is asking if Nigel missed his deer, and that's the real reason he's not here. There might be some truth to that, but that's not the reason why he's not here.
Nigel did not even spot a whitetail. We did see a muley, and one of our buddies got a tag, and we, made sure it worked. Anyway.
Zinx is carrying his mini bull mastiff, and his XE, I always pronounce this thing wrong.
Zancudu?
It's the one that starts with an X.
Zancudu?
Zancudu, yes. Yep. Mr. Fisk is carrying his Mordax. Darren is carrying nothing but his razor sharp wit.
That Mordax is a nice knife, and Darren's wit is
not a nice knife.
Hit and miss. Hit and miss.
Oh, shit. Rude.
I want that Mordax. I want a Mordax.
Indeed. I'm sure there was other people that also commented, but I've lost their messages. So I'm coming back.
That's handy.
We're gone now.
That's super
the
handy.
The chat keeps moving. It's a thing. I'm going to address something that Mr. Fisk said about how I don't know what the feel of velvet feels like.
Is that going to be the subject of this video?
Apparently it's going to be a quick aside, but
okay. Yeah.
I heard somebody else describe it as chalky, and that is right too, but still not quite right. Like, it's
but velvet, sir. You described it as velvety.
I described it as velvety because I couldn't think of anything else that it really felt like to me. It didn't feel exactly like velvet, but that was the closest that my brain could associate with.
I see.
Do you remember oil pastels from like art class and what those felt like drawing on paper with? It kind of feels like that.
Like really greasy. They're like grease pens almost.
Don't you dare call it greasy.
It's
just because you're Italian, right? It's mainly because you're Italian.
Clammy hands, I mean, everything feels greasy. Oh, now I'm sad.
Now I'm conscious of it.
People have been complaining about their hands drying out from hand sanitizer. I'm just
no, but it was a quick aside about the knife because the first question of the night is about this knife and the modification that a certain Dennis Fipers might have.
Dennis, the Phantom Menace Fipers. Just for you, Paul. Actually, Dennis.
You're such a nerd. You're such a nerd, Joe. Dennis, it's unbelievable.
Yes. Oh, yeah.
First of all, it's the Viper Fipers, if you're going to do it. Like
the Viper Fiper.
Yeah, come on. That's the natural nickname to have.
No, but you are a bit of a menace.
You can't give yourself a nickname. That's not how this works.
if we get to choose our own
nickname. My nickname is Bubbles, man. Bubbles, okay? Bubbles.
You know what?
Uncle Creepy.
Uncle Creepy.
You think he chose that for himself?
It's already taken.
That's what I'm saying. Do you think he picked that name for himself?
Oh, I hate that. Do you think he has that bad of a judgment?
Dennis Vipers Fipers. Thank you, Mr. Fisk. I appreciate that one.
That was the elementary school nickname. He nailed that one on the head, for sure.
Oh, that's opening old wounds.
I'm just going to bring up a picture here. There we go.
Of the Diaper Fipers?
No!
Like, No, I was a weird looking kid, man. Like, it's
how did
so Joe recently snuck into your house and found your old photo albums?
Yeah. No. I just pulled up a picture of Dennis's modified knife off of Instagram because I want to keep it up.
There. I see.
Yeah,
I see.
It's the right answer.
I think.
I thought this was.
Ben is sending chat that he resents the greasy Italian comments. So there's another one of us.
That was paying attention. One of us.
Damn Welshman, that's not a Welshman.
Hey, man, I found I was even more white bread than all y'all. So,
so I failed to actually save what the exact question that I asked was, but I basically asked what people thought of the modification that you did. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, to mm-hmm. your bailout.
How many answers? How many responses did we get?
We had 15.
Nice.
Yeah.
I'm happy with that turnaround.
What was the general consensus before we get into particulars?
This was the general consensus. Mm-hmm. He is good, yeah?
Yeah, he is good.
I'm happy everyone's happy with the outcome.
Indeed. I won't say everybody. We'll get there.
Yeah, yeah.
Right off the hop, though, Indie Hammer 91, he made that knife about 100 times more appealing. So that's a pretty ringing endorsement.
There are some people who just don't like Tontos.
That's it.
I'm not saying they're wrong.
Gone, sons of bitches, gone.
Zinx is saying in chat, how dare you? So I assume he's talking to you, Dennis.
It sounds like he's got feelings on the matter.
Yes. How dare me for de-tantoing it? Yeah, okay. We'll get there.
We'll talk.
Mr. Fisk is of the same opinion, actually.
It's okay.
Mr. Fisk said, disappointment disappoints tonight at 11.
Okay, I have a counter argument for that. I don't know how he scores maple leaves, but I have a comment that said 8 out of 10 maple leaves on the post that I did on Instagram.
Nice.
From Mr. Fisk.
Oh.
So I don't know if he had some time to sink it in and depreciate it.
Explain yourself, Mr. Fisk. You're here.
And the best part is in the second segue, I was actually going to apologize to Fisk because last week I was extra hard on him with the Frankenstein monster thing. And I was going to chalk it up to Joe not being here to pick on. But really, it comes down to, and I think you can all attest to this, is the more I get to know you and enjoy your company and whatever, the more of a dick I kind of am. And I think you can both agree that. I am probably pretty accurate in that statement is because we all just realized that it's a joke and we enjoy
why we get along. Mr. Fisk has told us numerous times in chat that his main goal while he's here is to fuck with us. So I think we're on the same page.
So, you know, I was going to do that apology.
He does say, I'm American. How do you think I score maple leaves? I don't know, but you did it with your own thumbs.
But you did out of 10, so like 8 out of 10. I'm just
that's like 80%.
What's the grading
system? Solid B. Here?
Yeah. It's not a metric system, so apparently the 10 doesn't actually mean 10.
He was talking about convection ovens at one point in chat. Okay. And that was the conversion for the night instead of giraffes. I don't know how a giraffe correlates to a...
Okay, the best part is I've got all of the measurements between the mufflers and the giraffes and so on and so forth. I've got a list of them, and I'm compiling a list of measurements to go with all of these things.
Very nice.
So, yeah, yeah.
Like it. Justin saying in chat, 5 out of 7. I knew Joe was going to like that. The Finest Tradition says that he loves it. Which, I mean, another ringing endorsement.
Well, that man likes his buck style knives, right? If I remember correctly, on the Finest Tradition. So we got a lot of clip pointy stuff. So I can understand how you would appreciate a drop point. But continue on. Yeah.
That's fair. Ahsoka Edge says, I think he did a fairly clean job. And I think from Ahsoka, okay. That's a pretty ringing endorsement, if I'm being honest. Just like,
I think that man knows his edges. I think
if I'm saying. You
check his account. Yeah, yeah.
Rust and Dust is saying that the Tanto is his favorite, which
yeah.
I don't know if it correlates, but he's Russian. Just saying.
I don't discredit blade shapes like they did it with the Griptilian.
Yeah.
Nigel's enjoying his Tanto.
It's the only Tanto in my collection right now.
With the scrapey action.
Yeah. The fact that Nigel's enjoying it in his collection and it's a Tanto is fairly strange to me. I mean, I understand and agree with his reasoning, but just the idea is very strange to me.
How low we scored the original Bailout.
We kind of shat all over it, didn't we?
Okay, but here's the thing, and I brought it up in part one of the video, is how biased our scoring system actually is. And realistically, if we wanted to be more accurate, we would archive other knives that we've scored relative to the knife we're scoring. And if we really wanted to be scientific about it, what's that, Paul?
Said I have. I have every single one that I've ever done saved.
Yeah. And I mean, most of us do and have them archived. Like, I could go back and find them for sure. But I think that we don't do enough back research and comparison compared to what we could do when we're scoring the knives.
That's fair.
Is, I think, probably what I'm getting at.
Yeah.
Remember what I was saying about Mr. Fisk being in chat to mess with us? He's saying that our scoring system is more asinine than his. And then a shush emoji. So...
Okay, but...
ours is definitely easier to understand, for sure.
Ours is at least in the same form of mathematics that the other 98% of the world actually live in. So...
every time the Imperial system is brought up, it makes me sad on the inside. Because making things means I have to deal with both systems, and I constantly have to jump back and forth between converting decimals, and I would love
an episode where we talk about improving our 100-point scoring system.
Yeah.
But don't get us wrong. It will always be a 100-point scoring system. I think that's the best way to do it, and we can give it grades and make it school mathematics because I think people like that type of thing.
I think it's
but a bit... I'm more than welcome to improving on the categories
I think it
with be... a valid conversation.
Yeah.
Right? So
I think that might be a worthy part three. Of an evening, just because it's a little, is esoteric the right word for this? It's a little bit meta, I think. But I think it is worth discussion, and I think it's worth getting the input of outsiders too, and see what other people think about that. But it's kind of like Shabazz actually put out a video somewhat recently about objectivity in reviews. Ultimately, we are humans; we have preferences, and there is going to be some level of bias, no matter what. I think that's why we tried to curb that by having a personal category.
Did he just recently put out a video about that?
He did, yeah. Within the last 2 weeks or something.
I hate that I was bandwagon jumping and I didn't even know it. About the biases and knives and stuff.
Mr. Fisk is saying that enthusiasm is not measurable, and I disagree. Whether or not I care that something exists... is definitely something on a personal level that I can give at least some kind of level of
a counter argument of a before and after syndrome, where when you see a knife initially for the first time visually and you're like, hey, I'm excited about that knife, and then the handling and the getting to play with it for the first time on whether it's a disappointment or whether it lives up to everything you want it to. And I think that's the easiest way to quantify enthusiasm for us because we do get to play with a lot of knives, right?
Yep.
So I think it's very much a before and after scoring category is,
it's,
hey, does that draw my attention and does it live up to what I want it to be?
And realistically, every single one of our scoring categories is on a it's on a spectrum of its own, where zero is effectively, I hate this, it shouldn't exist, and a 10 is, I want it right now, and if I had the chance to own it, I would own it right now. Like, just in terms of enthusiasm especially. But it's hard to stay relative in those, you know, in those types of categories from knife to knife. Because if we were going to talk about how good of a cutter this was, like we did in the last episode, are we going to compare it to every other blade style similar to this that we've ever owned and cut with? Like, how...
And how much are we factoring in the cutting ability of that knife compared to the how much the thumb stud actually gets in the way?
Exactly.
For a cutting ability category. Like, it's... like, that's why I wanted to asterisk that category as well, is because the knife compared to the opening mechanism are two different things. And if you modified that opening mechanism, the knife itself would improve greatly, probably, on cutting ability. And I overranked it on cutting ability because I was scoring more of the knife than the thumb stud. But anyway, yeah. And you've got comments in chat? I'm sure you do.
All I'm going to say is, Justin, stop it. Just leave it alone. Stop.
I mean, Justin needs to leave a lot of things alone sometimes, but, you know.
Yep. He did say 5/16th of a mil over an inch, which made my heart sad. So thanks for that.
There was a, after hearing Paul say that, there was a very strong urge to just reach over and just end the stream mid-sentence there. Just like, going to bed.
Yeah. And we're done here.
I'm done. Anyway.
On to the next comment that we got in from Mad One Outdoors.
Yes.
That he loves the, what Dennis did, he loves it in that knife. Knife Cully said, that's a great idea. And then he copyright marked it to Matt Carricker, who's the guy from Demolition Ranch. And I don't know the reference.
Okay.
I don't know Matt. He's well known for saying, that's a great idea.
But maybe he's got a bailout. I don't know.
No, he's got a... I want to say it's a Benchmade out the front.
You can modify those too. It's cool.
Fair enough.
Quick.
You can take all the tantos off, all of the blades. It's fine.
Quick.
Ben
note.
Is asking in chat, is getting into Imperial versus Metric the same as talking politics?
It is if you're American. There's not too much of a dig on our
viewers. It's not too much of a dig. Americans that I've talked to have been very defensive about it, especially when I'm trying to talk to them over the phone and they think I'm just a dumb Canadian.
Hey man, don't get me wrong. When someone says, how tall am I say I'm 6'4", or whatever, 6'3",
oh,
now, whatever.
Yeah, that's
the thing. It's, we're hypocritical in that is because we use it because it's convenient for certain things.
That's just it. And right? Like, I don't know about you guys, but when I was going through school, well, both post-secondary and just standard education, there were certain instances where, like, it makes sense to talk about this in inches and this in centimeters. Because, like, if you tell me you're 170 centimeters tall...
I have no frame of reference. Hey,
okay, cool. Like that doesn't mean much of anything.
And that's what I mean about us being hypocritical as Canadians is like we rag on the imperial system, but we steal it when it's convenient for us.
It's
right?
Forced down our throats, though. Historically, I mean, that being said, most of you know, tons of manufacturing.
I was taught both in school.
Tons of manufacturing
because of the Americans.
For me, it's a base.
Anyone who came to Canada, it was just because they got kicked out of the southern states and they had to come up to where it was north, where no one else wanted to go, right?
That's
when you get to the Arctic line that the population drops, like, significantly.
Yeah.
But they pushed us as far as we could go, which was, like, within 200 miles of where the border is.
Yeah.
Mr.
And then
Fisk
they made a border and said, stay where you are.
Yeah. Get up there.
Go on, get.
Exactly. Mr. Fisk is saying, every week y'all point to your chart full of scores. And I just think of the scene with Charlie from It's Always Sunny when he's explaining the wall of info and he's like pointing at all the strings and the...
Yes.
That's perfect reference.
That whole episode was gold. Man, but that scene in particular was fantastic.
Yeah, no, that's, like I said, that's bang on. That's exactly what we do every single week, and we hope you enjoy it.
You know, Ben, in chat, but also in our poll here, said, nice job. Looks great. Or sweet, excuse me. Said, looks sweet. J.S. Artisan, or Jay Sardison, maybe?
Yeah. Boy from Calgary. He's a fantastic man.
Indeed. Is it Jay Sardison?
Something. I don't know. Yeah.
Okay. Should have come this way originally, which I wouldn't mind if they happen to catch wind of your little modification and go, hey, we're going to make that thing.
I think,
like I said, Griptilians, there's blade shapes for a reason. Like, there's no reason why you can't play that game. Like, make a sheep's foot. Just because Blade Chops did it first and then Wish copied it, you might as well do it too. Shit.
Yeah. it's your knife to begin with. What are they going to do? Sue you? Like, but honestly, I think that this is one particular design that I know it's like geared for the military, but realistically, it should have come with that profile to begin with.
I'm getting rid of the window punch, but we can talk about that after the comments are over, as far as military goes, but yeah.
Mr. Fisk is saying in chat, it's called a bug out. Yeah, then give me an aluminum handled bug out. I'll take that one too.
With M4.
Or S90. Take that too.
Can you, how's about that?
You can get M4 and a bug out in the customizer.
That's exactly what I was going to ask. Yeah.
You can. It's a true story.
I really want it to...
And honestly, you can get G10. So I'm sure if I got an M4 with a G10 on the bug out or something like that, I probably would hammer on it pretty good. Yeah. But probably more than I would want to as far as what a bug out is to carry type of thing, right? Like, it's so...
That's fair. Anyway. Parent6280 says it makes him want another bailout. So I don't know if he's saying that he wants, like, he had one, sold it, and now he wants another one, or if he wants a second one in his collection.
To modify.
You hear that, Benjamin? You hear that? People will buy variations of a bug out / bailout blade shape. I guarantee if you did a bug out with other blade shapes too, people would buy it if you did a Tanto, do a Tanto PM2, like, and don't make it exclusive, but make it a bug out and pound it to the market. I bet you that would sell like hell.
Indeed. Mr. Fist is saying, do you honestly think they won't release a special exclusive version down the road that costs $700?
Not with a drop point. They would probably keep the original blade shape, if I had to guess.
As long as they put C-Tech on it, it's fine. Don't worry about it.
Oh, yeah, it's fine.
can it glow, too?
Sure, why not?
Maybe.
Well, it's military grade, so there's a little LED built in that just blips.
I will also say that I'm not the first person to do it when it comes down to this blade shape. Last week, it got mentioned, and there was a guy saying REC did it. And I think he did it for a guy on Instagram called, like, Bearded Lover or Bearded EDC or something like that, and he said he got it done from REC, REC. As well as Rev Hiker on Instagram. Did it for a customer as well. Nice. So I'm definitely not first guy. I can't take credit for detantoing it.
I mean,
that makes it even that much easier for Benchmade to just be like, hey, that's a good idea.
Well, I will also say that you guys know how long I had that picture cropped in my phone about, hey, I'm going to do this to a bailout when I get it. And it was for well over a year as soon as it came out.
Yeah,
I was like, because I'm not scared to look at crazy stuff like that and change it and mods and whatever, right? So, Paul or Joe can actually attest to some of my knife making comes from a knife that actually exists.
Yeah,
that I'm like, I like this part, but I want to tweak this and this and this. And there's some CADs of like a 1930s kitchen knife that were just like, nope, I'm going to twist the blade shape and twist the handle and blah, 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 and make it my own design. But I like the premise of, yeah, like
it's still got this kicking around. So, yeah. There's something to be said for modification. And I bring this up every time the discussion in the shop turns to axes. It's like, you know, you can modify these handles. You can make them shaped however you like. Part of that comes from my background training as a jeweler. You would get your handle, your hammer handles. You shape them to your
purpose. Sorry, hang on for a second. Hang on for a sec, Joe. Okay. What's your comment there, Paul?
I just wanted to quickly shout out Mr. Fisk is saying River Edge Cutlery offers it for $15 to do that mod.
Okay.
That's REC, apparently, is River's Edge.
Rev Hyper did it, yeah. I just wanted to get the full name and everything out there for.
That's a pretty good price for that kind of modification. Because Dennis, how long did it
take? We talked about it last week, but you weren't here. So, you know.
How long did it take you to do?
About $15 worth. Because we talked about that last week, about how $15 I would probably do it. That makes sense. And if a customer dropped it off in the shop, I would probably like regrind and have no problem with doing that on $15. I would want a finer chipped black marker than what I had to work with. Let's put it that way.
Right.
I would start even drawing with just like a flow pen or something. Yeah, something like that, that you could really just like get precision.
Yeah. This thing's a friggin' Sharpie. That has like the fine tip on one side.
Honestly, I didn't describe it in last week's video, but one of the things I would do, and I didn't do on this one, but I might even black Sharpie a bevel on where it should go, and up to where a bevel should go, and then black marker actually have that. So when I am reprofiling and taking material off,
you've got a goal to aim for.
Yeah. And it's not just a black line of where you want it to shape, but it's a black line of where you want the actual top of the bevel, and like you're gauging that with, right? So,
I got you.
Yeah.
Anyway, not a knife. Knives just gave 2 thumbs up.
Nice.
I'll give the second one after I put down my beer. But anyway.
There you go. The bearded knife guy. Bearded knife guy says much better.
I'm not sure if he's the gentleman, but he might be the gentleman that actually had it done by River's Edge that I saw on Instagram. So
there you go.
That's funny. Yeah.
Everyday Caleb said it should be offered by Benchmade. And that's funny because Caleb has the bailout as well.
You bet. He's taken some beautiful pictures of that, by the way. I don't know if Caleb will watch this somewhere along the way, but he has taken some sweet shots on Instagram of the bailout. So,
most definitely.
Yep.
Mad Adam says, meh.
Awesome. Well,
you're not going to please everybody.
Can't win them all.
No.
I'll still say that there is I really like seeing people modify their stuff. Like,
I get why Nigel wants the scraper on the front. Like, I get why people want tanto edges. And for piercing power, and if it's in a black class military that they want lightweight, this thing's like a beefed up M16. And Kit Carson, and how many people have you seen talk about it being overseas and blah, blah, blah? Think about this as one of those, like, frame lock M16s, but on steroids.
That's
not an M60.
No, it's
an M60. Get your 21 away from me.
It's a 21. I was wondering if you'd catch that. But similar enough.
Yeah, because I don't know what I'm talking about.
Mr. Fisk in chat would like to know, has your enthusiasm score changed, Dennis?
On the bailout?
Apparently.
So
I'd have to go back and look at what it was. I honestly would. I don't know. Nigel would have those emails. I would have them too, but I would have to look them up.
Yeah.
And it's on my phone, which I'm not doing. So
that's
I definitely would say it's gone up, but I knew the mod was coming as soon as I saw it.
Mm-hmm.
Like I can say, like, you guys knew how soon I wanted to change that blade shape as soon as I saw it. And I don't even think the M4 was out yet before I was like, wow, that'd be a good looking blade in the drop point type of thing, right?
I remember you when we were looking at it on the computer covering the tanto and being like, well, that looks pretty okay. Like, almost like instantly being like.
So my enthusiasm probably would stay the same, because as soon as I saw it, I was like, the only reason I'm really dissuaded from modding a Tanto is if it does have a secondary grind. But the more the Hinderer does it, and with those Sponto grinds, and you can kind of get away with it now, like, even those aren't stopping me from kind of looking at a blade shape in a different light, right? And for me, it's just personal preference on my day-to-day use. I don't dislike the Tanto. It's just, it's not for me. It never has been, right? So
right.
It's not quite the same blade profile, but it kind of reminds me of my old Meyerco. What's his name? Greg Lightfoot?
Greg Lightfoot? Yeah.
Yeah. It's not quite the same severe sweep upwards, but
it is a little stubby, and I think I think it was last week, but I think I am gonna thin it out just even a slightly more. 943 701 McHenry, kind of almost give it a little more belly.
I'd lean towards the McHenry a little harder than the 940 for that knife, but that's my personal preference.
And just for the record, I know Fisk has one too, but you know, yeah.
He's got at least one.
That blade shape is a good blade shape for a bailout to copy, for sure.
Mm-hmm. Would you bother putting in the recurve, or would you leave the recurve out?
No, don't you recurve my shit.
Oh, I wouldn't be doing it.
If I could change one thing on a blur, I would pot belly it a little bit more and just have it kind of straighten out and spidey chef it a little bit, yeah.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I think you're onto something there. Justin said it's terrible, and he'll give you $50 to take it to the dump for you.
So that means Justin wants to keep.
Is that Justin in chat right now?
Yes,
same Justin we're chatting with. Yeah, yeah. Okay. Well, you don't have to take it to the dump because it's not going anywhere. And it didn't kick anything out of my collection, and my mini barrage is still here even. So
nice.
Yeah, yeah. You just have to accept it in the fold. You don't have to deny anything else.
I'm also pretty sure that Justin has tried to claim that the plastic version is superior in some way to the aluminum.
Last year or this year?
because he has actually even been talking about sending his in, hasn't he?
If he hasn't,
he I don't know.
Should, right? Like, I mean, that's a pretty serious upgrade. Assuming he can get it back over the border. But
for 3V, indeed. Like, yeah.
So the only
practical you can get that in the 60 plus.
I just want to address that particular.
Go ahead, go ahead, Joe.
Okay. I just wanted to address the particular idea that the plastic-handled 3V bladed version is superior to the M4 bladed aluminum-handled version, only insofar as that it's a more lightweight design. That's about the only way it's better, though.
And we're talking about still like heavier than 75% of Spyderco's market. Like, they came out with a lightweight Tenacious that's probably equal weight to what an aluminum bailout is. Like, the curve is so heavy on the Benchmade lightweight with the bug out and the mini bug out that everyone else is racing to catch up. Yeah. So even a bailout is chump change in weight compared to 75, if not 80, like whatever percent of the market. I'm going to make up a number and we're going to go with it. So
yeah. I like it.
Yeah.
Justin is saying in chat that he sent it a while ago, but hasn't heard anything back from Benchmade.
That's because they stole your knife.
They kept it for themselves.
I don't know if Benchmade's the same as ZT, but when I requested warranty work for one of my discontinued models, they sent me the screws without even replying to my email. So maybe your knife will just show up one day unannounced.
It could, but I bet you if you respond again, they will send another email out. I know sometimes I've dealt with Benchmade once where I had to send three emails. And by the third one, like within like 24 hours, it was just like, boom, boom, there you go. It's out the door. And I had a tracking number for it. So
cool.
Depending on who the QC, whatever customer service guy is. Yeah. If you get a little harassy, they'll get their butts in gear.
Mr. Fisk is saying in chat, call them. Cause that's the, advice that he gave me. And I was going to call them. I actually was saying to Dennis how I was going to call them. And then Dennis convinced me to email them instead, because I'd already waited over a year to even bother sending them a message about my 940. So what did it matter if it took a couple extra days?
The problem is that you waited a year. So why are you in a rush to get on a 1-800 number compared to an email? Like, you're going to get them eventually, and whether it's 2 weeks from now or a month from now, that didn't matter last July, so why should it matter now, right? So,
yeah. Mr. Fisk is saying it's 7 gas cans faster than emailing, so.
Okay. Am I working with some sort of electronic wave now as far as a measurement goes with gas cans? Is that how I'm correlating,
Dennis,
this?
I will leave this entirely in your hands, Dennis.
Oh, no. No, we're going to have some ridiculous stats. Like, I've already got some subplot on how I'm measuring giraffes that you guys don't even want to know about. Like,
I mean, I'm interested.
It's just the wang. He's just measuring giraffe wang.
Let's just put it in it's how many pieces can a lion herd or pack or tribe or whatever eat.
All right.
Don't they eat it all as one?
There's some scientific division involved that we're using nature to solve our answers for us. It's, yeah.
Fair enough. Before we move on to the next question that we asked for people tonight, I just wanted to quickly address the fact that I took a bug out clip off of my bailout and put the long clip on. And I don't know if I've decided to keep the long clip. But I do back pocket carry this thing a lot. That was almost a sentence. And I think the extra length in the pocket clip gives me a little more peace of mind that it's going to stay a little bit more secure in my pocket, but without being grabby on the pocket in a way that makes it difficult to remove from my pocket, if that makes sense.
I agree with you.
I may have said pocket one too many times.
Too many pockets.
So, as soon as I saw it, I was like, aesthetically, that looks terrible. Don't do that. And I did not do it because I think aesthetically, the bug out clip still looks superior to the full-sized. Ergonomically, it didn't bug me. But, yeah.
Like I said, it was a thought that came up last week, so I tried it out. Which means I put a bug out clip on my H&K Access, which might make Mr. Fisk froth at the mouth a little bit. So
it looks better on the mini, but we'll let it go on the full sized. Yeah.
On that note, Justin's actually mentioning in chat that it's more secure in my back pocket. And what is it you were saying about having a tapered base before? Taper's okay towards the end there. That's all I'm saying.
Depends on which pocket you're talking about.
We're talking about the prison wallet. Yeah. I assume that's what he's talking about. On to the question, though.
All I can do is shake my head disapprovingly.
What are your thoughts on buying a knife with the intention of modification?
I mean, that's kind of, yeah. So do we want to give our answers then before we...
I don't have any of my knives near me that are anodized stuff as well. So I think that falls under the same category of you are drastically changing potential warranty work and things like that.
I can't think of a knife that I've really done anything more than changing the bevel angle on. Except for my Spyderco Phoenix, which I anodized purple. But that's the only thing that comes to mind. And that was not intended when I bought it. It was just, this is titanium. I'm anodizing this other titanium. I want to see how this looks like it. Yeah, but Dennis resharpens his stuff all the time with stupid edges because he likes to do that and he's a bit of a monster. So there you go.
You say you like to change angles, you say.
Yeah, but even that, it's like it's so minimal. That the thing you just showed off, what did you say, a 12-degree edge?
Like 12, I, it's somewhere in that 12 degree angle.
Like yeah. That's goofy. The furthest I've pushed a lot of my any of my knives really has been like the like a
and that's maybe a that's 15 an M or 14. That's an M390 on the 62.
Yeah, if you put that knife near your ear, you can start to hear the angels hum, but that's just the blood that you accidentally from where you accidentally cut yourself.
Yeah. Yeah.
So don't be listening to it, knives. It's not a hard use knife, that's for sure. Yeah. But
it'll peel a deer like a banana.
At a 62, it is slicey as all get out. The get outs all get out.
All of them.
Yeah.
Hey Joe. You were supposed to come up with a curse at some point, and you should curse us right now.
You sure? Come up with that.
Well, let me come up with one on the spot. If you do not go like, subscribe, comment, you know, give us those engagement that the YouTube algorithms and Instagram algorithms enjoy, your blood will curdle like sour milk, and your family will never find
that
your body.
That took a dark turn.
Okay, so these curses have gone from slight annoyances to actually like just
straight death. Up death.
We've
threats.
Got the rig horror movie going on with Joe's death threat. Yes.
Yeah. Freaking the plagues of Egypt over here.
Don't worry.
Like and subscribe.
Curdled like sour milk. Yeah, like and subscribe. Fuck.
I don't like any of that.
Okay, so you get the choice. If you want to die that way, you can. Or you get the cursed light. No. All your pocket knives are dull. Always. Ben, they will never become sharp
Ben
again.
Ben's saying in chat that he just liked the video. Save me.
Be better. Jesus Christ.
Save me. Yeah.
What was that? Nice. That new curse, Joe?
Oh, you get either that or your knives are dull. All of them. Always. You can never sharpen them. If it's sharp, someone hands you a sharp knife, as soon as your hand makes contact, dull. Immediately.
What about that, like, tungsten carbide one?
Dull.
Does that go dull?
Doesn't matter.
Sandrin?
Sandrin? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Dull, and you're forced to sharpen it. Which, from what I understand, is a monster of a chore.
So, Joe's not allowed to come up with any more curses, right?
Hey, like that second curse was pretty Nigel PG. That was okay.
That second curse was still a dick move.
Oh, yeah.
I use M4, you son of a bitch.
I was going to curse people with, like, when you get out of the shower and try and towel off, you can never get fully dry. You always feel just ever so slightly damp.
Just
and
like when you put your socks on, it just sucks, right? Like it's anyone, like one of those, you know, right?
That's
like,
it. Perfect. I have a curse. I have
no,
a curse.
No, it's too late. Joe went
every time
everything
you
up this
put
week.
On a pair of boots. One
and
of
then he tried to get a second curse, and now you're trying to get a third week curse? This curse thing has gone to shit. Like,
I thought we should have a knife-themed curse because, you know, it's a knife channel. And if we're going to curse people, we got to make it really suck. So, there you go.
Dude, M4!
We
That's
talked
timing.
About curses
You're
so much, dick. Somebody left. So, on that note...
Oops.
Toms...
It was Fisk, wasn't it?
I don't blame him.
Enough.
I'm doing this so often, I can't count. Very few knives I own were perfect as I wish them to be. Tim Allen, 321, says,
okay,
dumb.
Hang on a sec. With Tom's, though, I don't see a ton of, like, blade mods and stuff, so is he just talking about, like, internal cleaning and stuff like that type of thing?
He must polishing
I'm
and things like that.
I mean, he's not joining us live, but, yeah, it's I don't see too many blade and or handle mods. So I'm guessing that it's just action related, maybe spring tension on the lock bar, which don't do to this knife. Joe can tell you all about it.
Yeah.
Don't do it.
Yeah.
Joe didn't tell us anything about it.
So,
good job, Joe.
Well, I'll tell you, I can tell you about it now if you like. So talking about variability with the QSP Penguin, the one I got milled into me, that one had incredibly weak lock bar tension to the point where it didn't feel like it had a detent. And I was in the middle of retensioning some other lock bars from other knives in my collection, so I thought, hey, I'll do up the QSP Penguin. Pretty simple matter of disassembling it, sticking it up in the vise. Yeah. I'm basically trying to increase the detent by increasing the lever arm tension. And it's a really simple process. It had worked for every other liner lock in my collection up to that point because I did it to all of them. And with less than the same amount of pressure with the QSP Penguin, just ping, broke the liner clean off and gave myself a blood blister. I was very upset with myself. I ruined the knife. Thankfully, this one actually has a really nice detent. It pops and it stays in position, doesn't wiggle out. So I'm happy now.
What are you guys' thoughts of this as a slip joint?
The QSP?
It's not a slip. It's not a slip joint. It's a friction folder.
As long as it had a proper half stop.
I'm not making a back spring for this thing. Screw that.
I said slip joint. I should have said friction folder.
Yeah. Well, you're wrong. It should be a slip joint with a half stop. So try again.
I would actually quite like that as a slip joint, to be honest. If it did have a back spring of some kind, yep. I would like that. As far as a friction folder,
but you were talking about friction folder. I would have to have a tab friction
folder specifically because Joe broke the lock bar. That's why I was mentioning
it. Yeah. If I
you'd have to have an extra for it to kind of fit into your stuff, right?
You had to tighten it down more just so it wasn't scary.
Yeah, because the detent, it would need a tab of some kind.
All right, I'm moving on to the next answer.
For sure.
From Tim Allen, 321. He said, dumb move if you plan on keeping it, or don't plan on keeping it. That's a very, very strong distinction.
Well, this goes into another question we had a while ago about planning to buy knives to keep or planning to buy knives to maybe resell them in the future.
I think it also comes down to price point on the knives as well.
Yep.
Like, I think that's a huge key in something that you don't care about, something compared to something that you pay thousands of dollars for that you've got a mod on top of that or whatever type of thing, right? Yeah, so
no shit, hey. That's always a sketchy situation when you're trying to make changes to a pricey knife or a knife that you just can't find anymore.
People spidey whole Sebenzas, right? I like it, by the way. I like spidey gold Sebenzas.
They're nice.
Just for the record.
I do too. But I think... Sorry, Paul, go for it. I just noticed
you were
waiting to say.
Well, I was saying, does Tom's have a lot of like clip replacements? MXG and Lynch clip and stuff like that, maybe?
Maybe.
That was my original thought when I was talking about modifying was like,
that's a good point.
Like doing what you did to yours. Something as simple as swapping a clip can change the feel of a knife, right?
Rip's Garage Tech has a Techno Titanium clip that's been calling my name for a while. So shout out to Rip's Garage Tech. Yeah, so.
I still need to email MXG to find out what clip will fit my swayback because I want to replace that piece of crap.
You've been trying to write that email for days. But yes, you should definitely get on that because that knife needs.
Well,
a new clip.
It's right after he finishes that email to Benchmade.
Well, the one to Benchmade was sent. Yeah. I have to resend it and be like, "Hey, I talked to you guys. What the balls, guys?"
Sounds about right.
On that note, on to the next response from Indie Hammer 91. It's a fairly new thought to me. It's changed how he looks at production knives, which is kind of cool. Like,
yeah,
it definitely can make or break being like, well, that handle's awesome, but that blade, I'm not a tanto guy or I'm not a.
And I know that we were talking earlier in the episode about like blade chops that's got into it. But I think we also have to give out another shout out just because, I mean, we like Nick Maffei with the skinny paras and some of the other mods that he did as well type of thing. He got brave on his. Well, we did a shout out because he passed away earlier last year or whatever it was, right? So
that's it, yeah.
But yeah, he was the one that was kind of the originator on the skinny paras that have now kind of taken over and a whole bunch of other people are selling them, but I'm pretty sure he was kind of the pioneer in that, right? So
That's it. Mr. Fisk said it in response, ain't got no issue with that, just Dennis.
Damn straight. Damn straight.
I don't know why when I talk in Mr. Fisk's voice, I give him like a hick voice, but
you know why. You know exactly
you
why.
You almost made me say something really mean, so let's move on.
The finest tradition said, I've seen so many knives that are great, except for one thing. If you can change that, go for it. Which, yeah.
It is
a fair answer.
It is.
I don't think you should be willy-nilly about it. I think you should be deliberate about like your thought behind modding a knife before you do it. But
it's certain things are harder to change than others as well. Like. Yeah. Like I've actually noticed on certain knives, it's like, yeah, this is great, but the detent sucks, and I don't want it opening my pocket, or I want it to be a little bit more poppy when I do. I've looked at detent balls, and they don't seat fully into the blade hole, so it just kind of, like, floats there. So it's like, oh, so no matter what I do, unless I enlarge... I know Paul's just going to laugh, but unless I enlarge that hole properly, nothing's going to happen. And it's
well,
just...
Sometimes
it's just a big risk.
You need to slowly coach the hole to be bigger than it is, right?
Well, yeah. Like, and if you, but then you're looking at precision tools like, hey, now I need drills and reamers, and I if I'm going to do this right, I want it to be done.
Yeah,
properly.
You do.
Oh yeah.
Two things.
I'm just going to
start
talking.
First, Mr. Fisk just said in chat, last week you killed me. This week you stereotype me. I don't know which one cuts deeper. And Ahsoka Edge actually kind of agrees with both you guys, saying if you have the means and the skill and the confidence, go for it. If you don't know what you're doing at all, do some research, figure it out, start small and work your way up. Don't just
profile
a blade with never
don't mod a bailout without being confident that you know what the outcome is going to be.
Yeah,
and ultimately, I was very, very confident on knowing what the outcome was going to be when I started doing that, or I wouldn't have done it, right? Like,
that's
what it comes down.
There is a good argument. I mean, like, we've even given advice to people saying, hey, if you have a cheap, crappier knife and you want to learn how to sharpen, maybe you should learn on that cheap, crappier knife rather than starting on your Henkels or starting on your Shun or your Global or whatever nicer kitchen knife you have. Maybe you should buy that Gerber paraframe to see if you can detonto it and take the serrations out and see if you like the look of it before you try and mess up a $250 Benchmade.
Smiling at there, Paul?
Mr. Fisk said, don't saw a 940-2 in half. He had a stuck screw that...
I've
seen the video.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure I saw the live story when it happened.
That was good.
It kind of made me cry and laugh at the same time.
Yeah.
It was
a little heartbreaking. And then Benchmade's response, and then his response to Benchmade was pretty good.
That's it. Big J Blades says, your knife, you do what you want, but it voids most warranties. Know your warranty first.
Yep.
And I think it also depends on what you do.
That's a fair argument, but but that ties into know your warranty, right? Is knowing which company allows you to kind of get away with what kind of stuff, right?
Yeah.
So,
like, how does
Spartaco maybe being stringent than Benchmade or Kershaw?
I was just going to ask you about Spartaco, because a lot of guys like to do regrinds on Spartacos. Either to make them hollows or FFGs. What's their take on regrinds? Because I know
there's no blade replacement. There's no blade replacement.
Yeah.
You get it the way it is. If you want warranty on the handle or something like that.
Yeah.
But if you regrind the blade and then something happens to the blade, like even if it breaks after you regrind it, there's no way that you're going to get that warranty because of what you did to that blade before it broke.
Yeah.
But if you... Spartaco, if you break a blade, they will reprofile it for you, but they won't give you a blade replacement. I know
they will already do that. So again, like, good luck. Like, so if you mod a blade in particular, or mod a handle, like, I highly, highly doubt that you're going to be able to get a new handle for a PM2 if you mod it and F it up or something like that.
Yeah, right? But if I had damaged the G10 sanding out my Para 2, they would have been like, buy some aftermarket scales. Go fuck yourself.
Dug it in too deep and stuff like that. And honestly, what Spyderco would charge you for normal replacement scales, you're probably better off buying an aftermarket scales, and you're probably getting nicer scales anyway for a similar price point. So why wouldn't you turn it into a project knife at that point, right? So
would you guys think that an anno job would void a warranty? Out of curiosity?
Yeah, for sure. If you did it on a titanium Spyderco, and because you might have heated it up, it's electrode, and what if you weakened it and they can't, like.
What about ZT?
I don't know.
That's if
they're much more point and click with their warranty.
Yeah,
that's true.
There's a lot of times where you're just like, I need this part, blah blah blah, and you don't need to actually like have the knife on hand. You just kind of have to say, where'd you buy it and when'd you buy it? And as long as they're a valid dealer, then they're like, okay, we'll play ball, right?
Well, so. And that's kind of what Joe touched on too, right? Was that he sent an email and they didn't even email him back. They just went, here's your parts.
Yeah. The one thing that kind of irritates me about the
it's kind of like Manly Knives Bulgaria, but the difference is
they don't exist anymore. Wow.
Mr. Fisk is reiterating in chat that you can't hit the hole.
Sure you can.
What's that?
Look.
Mr. Fisk is saying in chat, can't invent a hole.
Spyderco invented the hole.
They've done it multiple times.
They did it. Yay. Paul, join me. No.
I don't like the way you said that joke.
Yeah.
I can't.
Well, you can
only see part of me.
Just got to open the knife.
That's still too much.
Probably more smart.
For the record. No, keep it closed. It was better that way.
There we go.
Perfect.
Yeah.
That purple blade is weird, Jod Joe. Invented the hole.
Sorry? Jod invented the hole? Yeah.
Jod, yeah. And they weren't able to patent it. They just were able to...
They trademarked it.
What?
They trademarked
it. Trademarked?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think if
specifically they, because you can't invent the hole.
If they did patent it, pretty sure the patent would have run out by now anyway.
Well, yeah, but
okay. So here's the thing, guys. Hey guys, we got to stop it right now. We're snowballing like crazy. We should have taken a break 8 minutes ago.
Oh yeah. Like,
oh yeah.
Like 20.
Gonna, okay. I'm just saying, Nigel's not here, and he's going to love this editing job. So maybe we should wrap it up.
It's going to be longer episodes. But we can go on. We'll have to come back and finish this question later.
We can finish it on the third. We got nothing else going on the third. Sure we got fights. We got a couple fights.
But
they're silly. All right. So it'll be good.
Let's take a quick break. We can color. Yeah.
Sounds good.
All right.
Ben saying in chat, damn government workers.
Government workers.
You think the government's paying
us to do this? I need a new beer.
Yeah. All right.
I got to be honest. It's also because my beer is empty.
Yes. Beer back soon. Haha. We don't need.